What's up, folks? Welcome to Afterburner here at Flames Nation. Oh, man. I really could use the win there, man.
God really damn it, we lost.
I know it's all in service of the tank. I know ultimately it's a good thing, but, dude, I really could use the win tonight.
Flames keep their eye on the prize. Still eighth.
Hey, New Jersey.
Eighth overall, last.
New Jersey won. Seattle won. It's a good night for the tank. But
great night for the tank.
I'm sitting there watching the I can't do it. It hurts me in my soul. It hurts me in my bones to lose the Oilers. I hate it. Anyways, I'm Mike. He's Jordan. We host the In the Dome show on the Nation Network. You've probably seen us around. We will be your what? We'll guide you through this group therapy session tonight. Hey, that's what we'll be. We'll be your guides.
I was really hoping that we could come on here and rub some salt in the wound, but...
We can rub some salt in the neck.
Oh, we'll poke a little fun. Yes. Oh. But we'll have to wait till the playoffs start in order to get our kicks to watch some Oilers' losses. We apparently are not good enough to beat them, even though they're just coming off of back-to-back games. They look tired. We did dominate a lot of 5-on-5 play tonight.
Yeah, the Flames pretty much they came out gangbusters too, which you really appreciate. I really appreciated that. The ice was tilted there for a while, eh?
Didn't even lose the special teams battle tonight. I think both teams had two power play goals.
We've scored power play goals in 5 straight games.
So they're doing a new setup behind the net. Is that what's happening? Because they're not trying the cross ice one timers still. And they got half their guys are still not on a one-time position, but they're scoring goals. So I'm not going to sit here and complain too hard.
Dude, the behind-the-net power play setup, I was so happy to see that. I don't know why they haven't tried that before. They haven't tried anything all year or for 2 years, whether Muller or Savard's been running it. It was, let's just try this 1-3-1 and see what happens. The behind-the-net setup is so underutilized in the NHL. It's super effective. In fact, I think they looked at the numbers a few years ago and – behind the net passes lead to like the second most goals on shots on passes from behind the net as to cross ice passes. So it's a super effective way to run a power play. And dude, they scored 2 goals on it. You saw that first Igor goal was so sick.
That was sick.
Like both guys behind, that's a set play. Both guys behind the net opens up so many options. Igor like circles back. That's way better than the static power play we're used to.
It was a decent night for Team Tank. So who Seattle wins, the Devils win. So you now have a 4-point cushion between seventh and ninth.
Dude, I think we can probably even catch Ottawa and Montreal at this rate.
We could catch anybody. No, just not everybody, but those two teams. So
those two teams we can for sure.
Currently we sit eighth, dead last, meaning you're in eighth spot for pick. What are the chances they could move up? So you're sitting here if they continue to stink, which, hey, I mean, we got bad teams coming up on the schedule. We'll get to that in a little bit here, but we can't be bad teams, can't be good teams. We're just a bad team. And we keep playing Markstrom. He seems to be the reason why, or not the reason, but, you know, one of the keys to our lack of success. Nothing works.
Good night for the tank, but I thought they played a really good game considering. And like you said, Oilers were tired. They looked a little disinterested at time. McDavid wasn't his usual self, even though he picks up 2 points and we had to hear about him all night and how great he is.
I thought the panel at least laid off a bit in the intermissions. Because typically it's Ron up there just on his hands and knees, folks.
Well, dude, that's why I wanted to win tonight. I wanted to lick some salty, neck-bearded Oilers tears. I wanted to see Ron McLean in shambles. I didn't get that. I'm super bummed out, even though it's good for the tank. I just wanted to see that.
It's okay. Save it up. Come playoff time. That's when it gets the juiciest. Yeah, anyways,
that's when you get your reward.
We got our one win this year.
Win, and it was glorious. And they played hard tonight. I was thinking they were going to come out flat tonight, especially given what we've seen. What? Every game other than the previous game this team played up at Edmonton against the Oilers, the games have just been flat. The Flames don't seem very interested in playing. There's no extracurricular activity. They played a good game. They played hard tonight, and that's a perfect tank game, right? Entertaining, fun game. Dude, I just wish they would have beat this stupid, dumb, ugly, disgusting, greasy, neck-bearded freaks up in Edmonton.
Greasy neckbeards. There couldn't have been any of those in the stands tonight, eh?
Well, there's none of them. There's only about 6,000 probably.
I guess we'll have to wait for that picture for a little bit. Okay, so they're
pumping. There it is.
There it is. There's one.
At least one Oilers fan's invading the dome, eh?
All right. What can we zoom in on that and see what kind of food we can find in there?
This is what I mean by neckbeard, folks. And Connor, at least they're just emulating their hero McDavid. Yeah, right?
You can't blame them. I mean, they're just looking up to the guy so much. They can't stop talking about him so much. They're just, you know, watching highlights of him every day. Just want to be like him.
Dude, it is a shame.
I mean, this guy is a spitting image of McDavid, is he not?
It is a shame that the dome is probably 50% Oilers fans every time they're in there. It's a travesty.
The dome was bad for that, but I mean, that's how season ticket holders kind of recoup some of their expense, right?
Yeah, well, you should be ashamed of yourself if you're selling your tickets to Oilers.
Yes, you've always made this point, and I do not disagree with you. Having it here, well, Leafs, what's worse, Leafs or Habs fans? Leafs probably won.
Dude, it's pretty bad when the Leafs are in town.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. It's like 50% Leafs fans, but the Oilers fans, it's totally unacceptable.
All right. So you got Billy Idol, the tour getting pumped. Hey, did you see? It's hit or miss nowadays. It used to be epic. Somebody posted this. It was what? How long ago was this? One of the intros to Hockey Night in Canada with a little montage with the song and all this stuff.
Oh, and it hits you right in the feels. It's so good.
So good. And one of them was just what, playoffs from how many years ago? Maybe you, I just sent that to you and you're like, why isn't hockey like this anymore?
Yeah, 2010, 2011 type. Yeah.
So you got the Billy Idol, you're like, oh yeah, Billy Idol, here we go. And then they shoot to Huberto. You're just like, oh, fucking buzzkill.
Hey, he got an assistant. He was okay. We got a frozen screen here.
Bat. Okay, you want to get to the highlight of the night yet? Is it time?
Well, let's just talk about overall thoughts of the game just real quick before we get to that sick play that'll be highlighted tonight. I don't know. What did you think of the overall game? Because they play a pretty good game. You know, it's about as well as they can play given their roster. I had some issues with, you know, not the lines, but I don't know. I don't like seeing Coronado sitting. I don't know. Some of the player deployment's a little annoying, but I did like Connor's area at center. That was nice to see. And just the overall effort was really good. Can't really complain too much. Oh, I think we got Jordan's frozen again. Oh, boy.
Okay, I'm back.
Are you back?
My internet was just cutting out. Man, there's been so many storms here lately. I don't know if that's what it is, but. I'm back.
It's that BC internet.
So overall game, like you said, man, I don't know. The storylines coming in tonight for me were Pospisil and Zari getting back in the lineup. Whew, there was a lot of speculation after the last game against the Jets that Pospisil might not be eligible to play due to suspension, but I think the league got this right. I think, Jack, we got a nice screenshot of this. If you want to put that up. But coming off the Jets loss. Okay, so this is a good little post from Tim. Feet on the ground, elbows tucked at contact, momentum through the player elevated, but the contact is a good hit. Look at that.
That was the one angle
we didn't see in the game, but if you really break it down, like, yes, this guy should have played tonight. 100%.
Yeah, I think they got it right for once. I thought the call was plenty. Like, if you wanted to call a 5-minute major, I didn't think it was, but that was a punishment enough, was a 5-minute game. That's fine. It's not a great hit. It's not a super terrible hit when you break it all down. So I thought the right call was made to not suspend him.
Well, you're sitting here like, fuck, if there's anybody I want to see playing the Battle of Alberta, the last one, especially if we're doing an afterburner, is Shit Disturber Piss Missile. We want him in there. Here he is.
Look at that. Look at that guy. Holy shit.
Here he is rolling the game tonight, ready to go. Hey, tinted visor, tinted glasses. Just living in Tintville.
Dude, let's just make one thing clear that I've seen a lot of this being bandied about. Oh, he's got to change his game. He's got to calm down. He's got to tone it down. Fuck that shit. Tone it up. Keep going. You're doing what you need to do, Marty.
No one better tell him to tone anything. Amp it up. Let's go play on the edge. Live on the edge. Yeah, you're right. There are some Flames fans that are already sick of him. But like I said, like, dude, that's a clean hit.
Yeah,
it's anyways, a clean hit. Yeah. You want him in the game tonight. I don't know what I'm expecting. I guess after you see Chucky just absolutely obliterate Zach Cassian three times and basically World War III start in Alberta, then you secretly you're always craving, you know, animosity and hatred and just WrestleMania. But didn't happen tonight. Thoughts on the overall game? I thought they battled hard. I mean, if you compare the rosters and the skill levels, I don't know. Did you look at the deserved win meter? I think we ended up outchancing them, did we not? 5-on-5.
Yeah, I think when it all shook down, the Flames scoring chances were at 5-on-5 were 30-18 for Calgary, 14 high danger chances to the Oilers 10. So a pretty solid 5-on-5 effort.
Just don't have the skill. Don't have the skill to
just don't have the skill. Yeah, and you saw that on some of the rushes, right? Like the Oilers come down on a 3-on-2 or on any kind of rush, 2-on-2, and they're creating offense. The Flames is kind of like, well, we got a shot. Got a shot attempt.
Did we, though? How many friggin' odd man rushes they come down? Just, well.
Well, this has been a problem for the Flames,
over.
Man.
Yeah.
And obviously, you probably noticed it if you've watched them all season, is they do actually generate a lot of shots off the rush, but they're not really generating a lot of quality offense off the rush.
I would say not.
I mean, even on 2-on-1s, we can't hit the fucking net half the time. So,
or execute a pass. We have so many plays die on odd man rushes for us. It's sad. If you're in the chat and you're saying hi, hello, we can't actually see the chat when we're on this thing. But get your questions in for later or topics in for later. The other big storyline for me coming in was Zari getting healthy scratch last game against the Jets and then making it back into the lineup tonight. I don't know. This pissed you off. It pissed me off. You're sitting there and Zari is a healthy scratch last game. And you're like, coach, like, what are you doing? Like, why? What's going on here? We're not seeing Dustin Wolf. We're not seeing, what was Coronado's ice time tonight?
Yeah. He played like 5:44 or something.
We're not seeing Coronado. We're fucking garbage time. Play the kids. Let's see what we got. Well, we already know what we got in Zari. He's been incredible all season.
Yeah, that's what pissed me off about the Zari healthy scratch was the rationale. Because I heard a lot of people say, oh, I was pissed off at first, but then I heard Huska explain it. And I was like, yeah, that makes sense. It didn't make fucking sense to me at all. It didn't make one iota of sense. It's like, I'm not going to just give out free ice time, even though we're not in the playoff mix. Free ice time. This guy's been your best player, 22 years old. He's been your best player since he's come up. The team totally turned around when he was called up.
Don't believe in giving free games to people, quote unquote. Excuse me? You tell me Zari hasn't earned to play every single game from here on out? I don't know. The was it Leslie? The broadcasts said that they saw or talked, was it Rudy saw or talked to Zari. He was very upset not playing last game. I wouldn't say he played any different tonight than we see him in the last.
Great tonight, played as he usually plays, and he looked really good. That line was awesome. So maybe you say, oh, he lit a fire under his ass or whatever.
I don't buy that.
But I don't either. Just based on what I've seen from Zari game to game, maybe there's been a dip in his play since coming back from injury, but that's coming back from injury. That's going to happen to everyone. So, hey, if the coach comes on and says, yeah, we wanted to give him a little break, just maybe a reset mentally, I don't buy the, I'm not giving away ice time. There's a certain standard. If there's a standard to play by, then why are half of these veteran guys dressing all the time? So I didn't like that, but dude, played a hell of a game tonight. That line, I know we took a few jabs at Huberto, but that line was dominant from puck drop tonight.
This is the Huberto, Zari, and Hunt line?
This is the Huberto, Zari, and Hunt line. And hey, like, thought Hunt was actually pretty good tonight for as much as we complain about him being in the lineup, but he shouldn't be, you know, like
we've seen this so many times.
Yeah.
For how many years in Calgary? You got bottom six guys with bottom six skill.
Yeah.
trying to try and score in top six positions. It just doesn't translate.
The Zary Huberto Hunt line has a 90.5 expected goals for percentage tonight. They absolutely owned the ice tonight, dude. Wow. They were great.
Backlund's line did a great job of keeping Connor and his line in their own end quite a bit.
They were good tonight.
When they weren't giving them two on O's.
But, oh, yeah, the 2 2-on-0s. Yeah, that was nice.
I can't believe they. So Connor didn't give that give Hyman enough of a tap in for that.
Isn't quite perfect enough of a pass and a quite open net for Zach Hyman to score his usual type of goal.
Couldn't quite corral it and put in the empty net. He just needed the tap in. Just really needed that tap in.
I really like Zary at center, though, just to finish up on Zary. He looked, and this has been something for me personally that I've kind of been wanting to see. Again, during garbage time, you should be trying these things. And I think that's ultimately why you're annoyed that he was scratched last game. Because this is something you've seen the Flames do in years past. You saw it in the bubble. Do you remember this? It's like in the bubble, they were out of it like in the 2021 COVID bubble year. They were out of it like...
I've tried to erase it from my memory.
Yeah, but it's like 10 or 15 games. They weren't like officially out of it until like maybe 10 or 8 games left, but they were out of it. And like Daryl Scratch, Valimaki didn't play at all down the stretch. Like none of the kids were like Valimaki wasn't playing. Nikita Nesterov was playing. Like all these old guys are playing. No Valimaki. He comes into camp the next year, has a shitty camp. You end up losing him on waivers. And I'm not saying that it's going to happen with any of these young guys. I'm just using an example as this is a time to start getting these kids into the rotation, getting them comfortable, getting them playing big minutes. You're in development time. I don't think you should be screwing around, you know.
Well,
and playing this weird, he's not playing up to the standard of the Flames. What's the standard of the Flames? You stink.
By comparison, if this was Daryl at this time last year, not getting Dustin Wolf's starts, not playing Coronado enough, it's healthy scratching Coronado, healthy scratching Zary, like food near the end of it.
Everyone's freaking out. And everyone, so.
The other storyline going into the game for me was Markstrom gets a start again. What did they say? He hasn't beaten the Oilers in over 2 years.
I said that. He hasn't beat the Oilers since game one of the playoffs in 2022. He played them. I think he's played them once this year at the outdoor game, lost. He played twice last year and lost. So he hasn't beat them since that infamous. And it's funny on the broadcast, they were showing the last time he beat them. He's like, I think DeBrusque or somebody said he played great. That game was like 9-6. He played fucking terrible.
That's when he started to not be able to stop a beach ball. Was that?
Yeah. Game?
All right. So the
streak continues.
Pospisil, Kadri, Kuzmenko line look good again. Maybe not the greatest in their own end, but that's not really what we're hoping for. But they're effective as well. You think so?
Oh, yeah, they had that one rush where this was a rush that was dangerous because of Kuzmenko's skill. It's a 3-on-2, and Kuzi makes that little, he kind of like turns himself, opens himself up, and slips it over to Kadri. He gets to Pospisil right in front of the net, almost tucked it in.
Oh, close.
Kuzi's up to, I think he's got 17 points in 23 games now with the Flames. 14 of those are primary points. Another 2-point night for Andre Kuzmenko.
Kuzi's cooking.
He's cooking, and there's been a lot of talk. Like, what do you do with this guy? I think for now you just enjoy that he's playing some good hockey. Enjoy it. Again. In times like these, you need a reason to tune in, and a guy like that's going to take you out of your seat every once in a while.
Had we seen this rendition before with Backlund, Coleman, and Sharangovich, or is this the first time we're seeing?
We saw it a little bit earlier in the season when Sharangovich was kind of jumping all over the place. I mean, anybody can play with Backlund and Coleman. I actually don't mind that as a spot for Igor because those are two guys that notoriously create a lot of chances, but on ice finishing has been an issue. You get a guy in there who can snipe with them. I think that's a nice little trio.
I mean, it could seriously water down his offense. So we'll keep an eye on that. But
yeah, I think
for now you're in garbage time. Let's take a good look at it.
Yeah.
And what do you think? Go ahead.
Igor scores his 30th goal of the season tonight. Let's talk about Igor, man.
You want to talk about what do you do? Like, so Igor's got one deal on his contract after this year.
Yeah, he becomes a UFA after.
Sorry, next one more year.
Yeah, so he's one more year.
You know, this is Connie's boy. This was his first trade. You know, he's gonna probably try. He's trying to sign as everybody. So I don't know. Like, you think Conroy is good trying to lock him up?
Yeah, probably. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a deal done in the summer.
What kind of deal do you want to see, or would you want to keep him, or what do you think?
Well, yeah, here's where the conversation gets interesting, because this has been a talking point about Kuzmenko. It's like, yeah, like he's going to be 20, what is he, 28 now, 29? Like, do you sign him? What do you do with him? I think it's a valid conversation to have Bortsharenkovic, because does he fit your competitive window in terms of his age?
How old is he? 26, did you say?
He'll be 27 if he signs one. He's 25 right now. I think he turns 26 in June or July.
So, well, he's right on the cusp.
He's right on the cusp. He's probably a guy you prioritize keeping, just how well he's fit in and how well he's meshed. But
yep. And also, for you want some stability. I mean, this year, and the team did a really good job amidst of all of it. Just the revolving door of players coming and going, and new signings and old guys leaving. It's just like, you don't want to like keep doing that for, like, you want to have some stability. You want to have guys building chemistry season over season. I think keep him. Like,
keep him. He's got the skill. He's got the tools. He looks like a player. Again, like, something I kind of look at with players who are like, you know, oh, he's going to be 29, 30 in X amount of years. You look at the hard miles on players. Like, he doesn't have a lot of hard miles. He hasn't played a ton of games necessarily. So I think if you lock him up, the value you're going to get back on that is going to be more than you could potentially get for him in some kind of harebrained trade where you're just like moving this asset. If you ever do need to move him, he's signed, you can maybe move him that way. But dude,
you're saying lock him out. How long are we talking here? What would you want to see?
Well, I mean, I don't think anybody wants to see anybody commit who's not a franchise player be signed to a max term deal. I mean, 6 year deal.
Doobie doobie doo.
You're only 7 years left.
Only 3,492 days.
But dude, it's pretty crazy given that everybody shit on the trade, including me, that he scores 30 goals, first 30 goals season in his career. He's the first Flame.
First franchise record.
First Flame since Mike Camilleri to score 30 goals in his first season with the Flames. And Mike was a beauty.
Yeah, Mike was a beauty. I remember I was working at the International Hotel. And so one of the part owners, Bobby Libben. Or what's his dad's name?
I think it's Bobby.
Libben? Bobby Libben?
Oh, Alvin or something, yeah.
Alvin Libben, his
like a
his,
Flames owner.
Yeah, so he owns part of the International Hotel. So
yeah.
Anytime new players came in, they would stay at the hotel. So when Cammy first got to the city, he came from LA.
Yeah, LA.
Yeah, he was like, dude, everybody knows you here. It's crazy. It's like you guys are nuts. Like, he's talking about the fans in the city. I was like, yeah, dude, you're a fucking superstar now.
Dude, they blew that one. They blew that one with Camilleri, man. Daryl fucked that up. He let him walk, and he signed Bomeister instead. That was a big mistake.
One of many. So we're talking up Sharenkovic. Did we do the highlight of the night? I think it's time.
Oh, yeah.
Hey?
It's time for a snipe from Igor. Another snipe from Igor! Junction with Camilleri, eh? Because that's really the guy I keep coming back to with his shot. It's like he's the best like kind of outside shot threat I've seen on this team since Mike Camilleri.
The highlight of the night's brought to you by Betway. Get the Betway app on your phone. Bet the responsible way with Betway. With Betway, you can get a free bet up to $200 if your first bet loses. So what you do is you create an account, scan the QR code on the screen, redeem your bonus, place a bet. No minimum amount required. And if the bet loses, you get a refund up to $200. You can then use that money on your bet or to bet on your favorite sports. This offer is only available outside of Ontario. So we are good.
Any bets tonight? You had a few I saw.
Oh, I made some bets. Yeah. But I haven't redeemed this $200. I was going to bet $200 on the Oilers.
Fuck you.
And then if the Oilers win,
how dare you?
Coin.
I'm gonna have to walk off right now.
I'll save it for a playoff game, but that's when I'm gonna use that thing, because like a free bet, like go to the casino, $200 on red equals black, you get your money back. Do it again.
What did you bet? You had Igor scoring. What was the other one you had?
It was Igor scoring and Drysdale scoring. Ugh, and I bet $6 and I made $55.
Barf.
Not bad. Not bad.
Leon was a little less pissy than he usually is tonight, eh?
I think they all were. I don't know if it's like, is the battle. They know.
They're tired.
They're tired. They know we suck.
It's like pity playing us at this point.
Pretty much. It's like that was their C game. Good enough to beat us. Ho hum. On to the next one. Fuck. Do you want to talk about the others? Like,
I don't know. I've heard about them all night. I don't know if I can talk about them anymore. If I have to hear the word Bush bomb one more fucking time, I'm going to kill myself.
Bush bomb. What is this? This is like those drinking games. Take a shot every time Harner Ryan Singh uses the term Bush bomb. You'll be hammered. Imagine doing a shot every
time. We've been plastered tonight.
If you did a shot every time they said McDavid. And not even during play. This is like between whistles. You'd have to do like, you couldn't do shots of, you have to do like the little tiny draft shots like you Cowboys.
So wrecked.
The one time I almost died. I'll tell that story later. Anyways, Bush bomb. Fourth line, Greer, Rooney, Coronado. I think you just switch Coronado and Hunt, don't you?
Yeah, it's a perfect opportunity. Again, like, why? My question is just why? You know? What is the purpose of having Matt Coronado?
Time's not free, bro.
Oh, yeah. You got to earn it.
Yeah, you got to earn it now.
I thought Coronado's looked great since his recall. I don't know about great, but his skating looks better. He's definitely been working on that. His positioning has been better. I don't understand. I just don't understand what you're trying to accomplish. Like, what's he even on the team for if he's going to be playing 5 minutes a night? Like, this is a perfect opportunity for him to play in an intense game.
He looked good tonight.
He's fast. He had a few really nice, slick zone entries. Had on my notes here a few nice little plays he had. He got a little shift on the power play. Thought he looked good there. I just don't understand the rationale behind sticking him on that fourth line and not really playing him. Like, at least roll four lines when, you know, there's nothing on the line. This game means jack shit. So in terms of development, you like, and that's the thing. This is this catch 22 that coaches get into is like, well, if you're not going to play the players now when it doesn't mean anything, and then when the games do mean things, you're not playing them anyways, right? Oh, I can't trust this player in this game where we're still in the playoff hunt. And you don't play him, it just doesn't make sense to me.
I agree. Let's do an ad break because we got to get two of these things in, and I need to.
We've been yammering for too long.
Greta, it's our home away from home for Afterburner. We'll be there for live watch parties throughout the season. Should be your spot regardless, before, during, and after the game. Grab a cocktail, something from the menu, let the games begin, or maybe you get into the game yourself. Over 50 arcade games from vintage to state-of-the-art. Load up some credits on that Greta game card of yours and get at it. Greta Calgary, located at 213 10th Avenue Southwest. Check them out online, gretabar.com.
It's nearly the best time of the year. Playoff hockey is around the corner, and I'll tell you what, the Grey Eagle Resort and Casino is the place to be. Cheer on your favorite teams with us at the Stage Bar. Enjoy the big game on one of those huge screens over the bar with friends, drinks, and delicious food. Let's go visit greyeagleresortandcasino.ca for more information. Now, while I've got your attention, let me tell you about the happy hour at the Grey Eagle Resort and Casino. Let's make the most of the day and spend your afternoons with great drinks and food. Join us at the Stage Bar and Blaze Bar and Grill for our new happy hour every day, 2 till 5. Enjoy food, drinks, all starting at $5. Make the most of your days. Visit greygoresortandcasino.ca for more information. If you're thinking of buying or selling your home in the Calgary area, there's one guy you've got to talk to. That's Derek Newman of the Derek Newman Real Estate Group with CIR Realty. Buying or selling doesn't really matter. Derek does it all. He's a volunteer in the community, active in sports around the city, whether it's golf, curling, huge Flames fan. So talking sports or talking about the real estate market, definitely give him a shout. He's approachable, trustworthy, and hardworking. Also, Derek's got a pretty vast network. He's even got access to some homes often that aren't even on the market yet. And you can ask him about his complimentary home staging consultation as well. Buying or selling, call him or text him right now at 403-619-6661. Derek will make it easy for you. Get Derek and his network to work for you. That's Derek Newman. Email him at dnewman@cirrealty.ca. More post-game reaction right here. We're back on Afterburner.
All right, man. We're going to do Hungry for More in just a second, but I want to talk about Connor Zeri just a little bit more. Just a little bit more, because I love the guy, and I thought he was great tonight.
Are you hungry for more Connor Zeri?
Dude, I'm freaking starving for more Connor Zeri. That shift they had, was it late in the second? Late in the second period, Hunt, Huberto, yes. And Connor
was
Zeri.
Was it three minutes, over three minutes the Oilers were hemmed in?
Yeah, they just held them in. They didn't really get a high-quality scoring chance out of it, but an incredible shift, a great shift. And I just think he's, it's one game. The Oilers weren't great or sharp. He wasn't playing against their top line or anything. I just thought he looked I thought he looked like a natural at center. And I think him and Huberto did have a little bit of something. And that's the thing with these skilled players, right?
They showed the signs of a little bit of chemistry. Yep.
And that's the thing. Like, we like to shit on Huberto, and he's earned it. But I think if you're looking at his role in this rebuild or retool or rebar up your butthole or whatever they're calling this thing, I think his role has to be something along the lines of what a Yuri Hudler type guy was back when Gaudreau and Monahan were coming up. And if he can be a player like that for like Connor Zeri and other prospects down the line, that's probably what the best you can ask for. But again, that's why you'd probably like to see Coronado bumped up there a little bit.
I'd love to see that.
Just give me your breakdown of what you saw from Zeri tonight. I'm curious.
What I saw from him is what I've seen all season long. A guy I don't want to ever see healthy scratched again and then hear some BS comment about why he did it. But yeah, he's a great player, man. I mean, we talked about him from the start of the season. I think you see the same thing with Coronado. If you do like ISO cam on these players, they're not just having an impact where they're driving play to the net and whatnot. It's like little tiny plays all over the ice, little dishes, nice little reads. Like these guys get the game, they can think the game at a high speed. I think Coronado's just got to work on his foot speed, which is, I think, even looking better as of late.
Looks great.
But both these guys, I think Zeri for me has been, in your top three most valuable forwards all season long, most consistent.
Totally. And
one of your most consistent forwards in your rookie season, like that's like kudos to this guy. We'll see how he does in his second year, but. The whole Huberto thing's interesting. I think you have seen flashes of Huberto playing better. I wanted to ask you, what can we expect from Huberto next season? Is he not going to hit his lowest ever point total? Is he going to hit it this year? He's worse this year, right?
Well, he's what? Yeah, he got an assist tonight on the first Sharangovich goal. So he's what, up to 47 points? Is that right? He's probably gonna hit his career low.
You got six games left. How many points does he need to match last year's total?
I think he needs eight. I don't think he can do it.
Well, maybe. You got some shitty teams coming up.
Yeah, that's worse for the Flames. What are you talking about?
Seems to be worse. But I just wanted to ask you, without shitting on the guy, because, we do that enough if you listen to the podcast, and if you haven't heard it, check it out. But
unless you like Huberto, in which case, don't check it out.
What are we going to expect? Another same thing? Is it going to be the same thing next year?
Probably
is he gonna go back in the offseason and blow up some bigger balloons while he's training, or what's gonna happen? Like,
well, what changes? I think
the reason why I'm asking is you haven't seen him pop off. Has he shown? Since in this calendar year, this is probably the most consistent we've seen. You still don't see him taking over games. You still don't see him dominating on shifts. He distributes the puck well, and because of that, if he was playing with, more elite finishers, maybe he'd have more points.
Yeah.
But maybe Kuzmenko is one of those players. I'm just curious because there's so many question marks going into next season. He's one of them. But the offense, if you actually want to have a successful season by any stretch, then he's going to have to play a big part of that.
Here's his role next season. Freaking tank commander. Tank commander for that top 10.
Sure. Pick. Hey, sure. Like, I'm fine with that too. Like, we've been sitting here, what, in bottom eighth spot for a week and a half now, making no movement. We've lost how many seven of the last eight games? Yeah, I'm starting to get used to this, dude. And
2-8 in their last 10.
2-8 in their last 10. You're sitting there and you're like, at least the games are interesting. They pull their goalie again tonight, try and make to tie it up. At least they're in it till the end. At least the effort's there. You're seeing some nice pieces on the roster start to take, you know, fruition. I don't know. I'll be honest, man. Typically, when the team goes through this sort of a cycle, I don't watch as much.
You're just watching for Markstrom and Huberto now?
They're fucking watch the games. I'm going to talk about them.
Yeah, now we're forced to watch them. We have to.
Fuck, I gotta go watch this. Although the Oilers game, I was pumped for that tonight.
Well, it is interesting though too, like, because we hear a lot about this at this point, right? Like, this losing culture thing that comes up, like, oh, we don't want to have a losing culture. All that, like, they've lost. They're 2-8 in their last 10.
Well, and go back how many years, how many seasons, Michael?
Yeah, I mean, it's 35 years of having a losing culture. But I mean, just in the mic, if you're looking at it in the micro lens, like, 2-8 in their last 10, has it really been that big of a deal? Are you, like, looking at this team going, like, no, they don't try hard enough. There's a real lazy-ass country club culture being built here. No, there isn't. It's been fine. They've been playing hard most nights.
They've been hard, and they've been playing, I don't know what you want to call it, exciting hockey, but at least they're keeping it interesting.
I don't
almost every game has been, you know, pretty close down to the wire.
Yeah, I don't think the hockey is that inspiring. Like, they're playing pretty meat and potatoes hockey, but
they got some guys with some skill that can get, you know, can wow you. Like that one highlight with Pospisil almost bearing a backdoor, and even the Sharangovich snipe. Like, he could get snipe. We got some interesting pieces.
Could have used a little more tomfoolery with the Oilers tonight, and a little more going after McDavid. But
I thought so too.
Disturbing.
There was a few instances. You had Rasmus Anderson and Kane getting into it in the first period there. Nothing really comes of it. Did you see Coleman and McDavid? It wasn't even a collision. It was kind of like they're rubbing each other out. Not off, out. And McDavid, was that a dive? Did you see that thing?
Oh, McDavid's diving all. Dude, the officiating is one thing we didn't touch on, which is pretty fucking terrible tonight. It's all over the place. It was very game management-y for the Oilers.
Somebody commented that they like our sound effect of when McDavid hits the ice.
Which one? You do it best, probably.
Happy lookout, huh?
All right, man.
So, yeah, I could have used some more fisticuffs as well. But
yeah, no fights breaking out. No shit disturbing. I mean, Pospisil's kind of going to do what he's going to do. Who else do you really expect to get into it? Huberto was kind of throwing some fists there. Hey, I'll give him that. That was nice to see. Louis DeBrusque was – the Flames somehow got the penalty out of that shit, the extra penalty out of that shit. I don't know how that happens. Louis DeBrusque was like, oh, Huberto went in there swinging. I don't know what he was watching.
Kane and Perry were teammates getting into it on the bench. Now you see that?
This is why the Oilers won't win anything.
Dude, Perry has won. So Perry knows what he's doing, but dude, Kane is so full of himself.
Yeah,
he's such an idiot, man. I don't know if he's capable of winning. Maybe if he gets injured, they'll win. But if he's in the lineup, he's just gonna tear those guys apart.
Dude, they're sitting on the bench like yelling at each other, and you see this like every once in a while with Kane. It's like wasn't Draisaitl yelling at him the other night?
Yeah,
they hate each other, and I mean, I don't blame them.
All right, what are we getting to here?
All right, let's get to DoorDash. Hungry for more. All right, do you have any DoorDash tonight, late game?
I did not. No, I have not eaten. What did I eat?
What did you eat tonight?
Let me go back and think about this.
All right, with DoorDash, with restaurants, grocery, pharmacies, bakeries, flower shops, and more, DoorDash really has everything you need. Ordering is easy. You just open the app, choose what you want, and from where you want, and your items will be left safely outside your door. So if you're an Oilers fan, you never have to leave your mom's basement. You just use the DoorDash app. You're good to go. For a limited time, listeners can get 25% off and zero delivery fees on their first order of $15 or more when you download the DoorDash app and enter the code NATION25. That's 25% off. The code is NATION25. 25. All right, man. What are we hungry for more? I know what you're hungry for more of, for sure.
What?
Little Dustin Wolf.
I'm hungry for more Wolf.
Little Wolf Dog.
I'm hungry for more Wolf. By the way, that guy did leave his, the guy we threw up on the screen, he did leave his mom's basement tonight. So the DoorDash.
His mom dropped him off, probably.
Yeah. Picked him up, dropped him off. I don't know, man. I'm just like, I get it. Markstrom's your, he's your big number one goalie with the contract. But like, fuck.
That's
play me, Dustin Wolf. Like every,
I get
like,
it, but fuck.
Like, fuck. Six more games. I don't want to see Markstrom in three of those.
Well, my question is why? Why? Well,
because he's Jacob Markstrom, I guess. Like, is
why?
Respect
Who cares?
Because there's no free.
Guy hasn't beat the Oilers in 2 years.
There's no free ice time, Michael. No free games.
Unless you're Markstrom.
Like, people, I don't necessarily buy this. There's some fans that are worried that playing him now, you're just decreasing his value because we're losing every fucking game.
Yeah.
I don't really.
15 games at the end of a garbage time is not.
No, general manager, nobody's scouting right now for that shit. It's like, that's already been done. They already know who they want. Yeah. He's like in top five goaltenders for everybody's, you know, list across, you know, all these.
You're not watching the skeleton crew Flames where like Daniil Miramanov is the top four defenseman when he's played like barely played any NHL hockey over his career and being like, oh yeah, Jacob Markstrom is really taking a tumble down in terms of his value. You know what's going on if you're a scout or an NHL GM. You know the Flames are, this is what they are.
Yes. But like, if you're Jacob Markstrom, I get it. He's a competitive guy. He wants to play every night too. But like, you think he's going to understand if he's just six games out?
Well,
it's two fucking weeks.
This is what you hear about all these veteran guys. Hey, oh, they get it. They know the business. Then they would perfectly well understand. Like, hey, dude, like, this is a stretch where we're going to give Dustin Wolf four straight starts in the NHL for the first time ever. Seriously. You think they would understand that? No, like, that seems pretty. It seems like Jacob Markstrom knows what's going on. And I mean, give him credit. He played hard tonight. And he played pretty well tonight.
But like, how sweet would it have been if Dustin Wolf plays, you pull out the win and Dustin Wolf beats the Oilers?
Well, dude, and I'm getting a little tired of this like white gloves on Wolf thing. Like, you see a lot of, oh, Mickey, you can't put him out against McDavid. Kid's going to get shelled.
Fuck that. Put him against the best in the league.
It was confidence. This kid is confident. He's got confidence seeping out of his fucking anus, dude. I wouldn't worry about this kid. He comes out and is like, if I can see the puck, I'm going to stop it. Whoa. This kid's fine. He's had to battle at every single level. He's not going to stop now.
Now that's confident. Seeping? Yeah.
Wow. How many consecutive starts has Wolf had in a row? I'm not sure.
I think it's probably
not more than two.
They throw that set up there where Pickard has, was Pickard's 12th win of the season. Has Wolf even played 12 games?
I think he's up to 10, maybe. He's played 14 this year, I guess.
Like,
I
don't know if they went through the whole starts. They already went through the whole Jack Campbell fiasco early in the season. Pickard's played, he has 12 wins. And Wolf has only played 14 games.
I want to see Wolf. And I want, you know what? I want to see him against McDavid.
Exactly. I want to see him against Tricep. I want to see him against the best scorers in the league. Let's see.
He's going to be our goalie, hopefully, for the next decade. Let's see him against the team we're going to be competing against for the next decade.
So, yes, I'm hungry for more Dustin Wolf. Like, did Markstrom just play the last two in a row?
Well, Wolf played in Winnipeg.
All right, so, but they're like, he's...
They're kind of like going back and forth. Like, and I still haven't heard a rationale or a plan, and obviously the coach isn't going to give that on the media.
No, he did. He said that they're going to play, they're going to see lots of them.
Yeah, he didn't. That's not a plan, both, though. He's like, you're going to see lots of both of them.
Yeah, so I think they're just splitting the rest of the
game. Well, I wouldn't be splitting. I'd like to see Wolf needs to get a solid string of starts here. I think that's important for a goalie to get comfortable is, you know, not playing every other game or every second game.
So I'm hungry for more Dustin Wolf. What are you hungry for, Michael?
I'm hungry for more Edmonton Oilers losses. I know we're getting to that time of the year. It's I don't know. Is it my favorite time of year? It's definitely, I can't say that because it is very stress-inducing. Playoff time when the Oilers are in the playoffs and the Flames are not.
My favorite time of year is when you know,
yeah,
it's they're on the verge of elimination.
The elimination game.
Then or even just like, well, yeah, elimination game. Because with those guys, you never fucking know. But
so yes. I'm hungry for some more. I know it's a little preemptive here. They're like, what are we? How many weeks away from playoffs? But
two.
I'm starting to like my stomach's starting to rumble for watching the Oilers be humiliated in the playoffs. So I can't wait for that. Hungry for More is brought to you by DoorDash. So use the code NATION25. You get 25% off up to $10 value with zero delivery fees on your first order when you download the DoorDash app. Enter code NATION25. Dash that for the win.
How worried are you about the Oilers?
I try to repress that and push it deep down inside and not think about it until I have to. I still think they fucking pumped the Avs last night. That gets me a little worried.
It's a little worrisome, yeah. But they got pumped by the Stars.
The thing is, they still have the same weaknesses they've always had. Goaltending is always going to be a question
mark. But it's not as weak as it was. The defense and goaltending are two biggest weaknesses. But it's not as bad as it's been in previous seasons.
No. But it's still an issue, though. And when you're playing teams like Dallas and teams like Colorado and Vegas, who play big boy hockey, they play playoff hockey. It could be like that first bad goal that goes in on Skinner in the playoffs. Like, I'll be curious to see how the team reacts. So, I don't know. Maybe I'm just telling myself this so I can sleep at night, but it feels like the other teams have fewer weaknesses than them. But you could see McDavid pulling a McKinnon from a few years ago where he just went fucking ballistic in the playoffs and like willing them to a win. So, we won't think about that.
LA wins tonight and Vegas lost. Did you see this massive comeback? They were up 4-1 against Coyotes last night and they ended up losing. So as of right now, if playoffs started today, it would be LA Kings and the Oilers in the first round.
I don't trust LA to beat Edmonton.
Vegas still has a game in hand, though. So.
Yeah.
All right. One more ad break.
We'll come back with
the road ahead.
We are well into the winter months now, and you can feel it, can't you? That urge to get away. Maybe some beach time to warm up those bones of yours. Maybe a hockey sports kind of road trip. Well, when you pack your bags, make sure you don't forget Alberta Blue Cross. There's only one thing better than sharing memories, and that's making new ones. Alberta Blue Cross travel insurance protects your memories and more wherever travel takes you. Visit ab.bluecross.ca/travel for more information. Alberta Blue Cross, celebrating life's memorable moments inspired by hockey.
Hey guys, it's Pinder chatting about Charm Diamond Center. Did you know that Charm's been Canadian owned and operated since 1972? And there's over 85 locations coast to coast to coast with Charm and their sister brands. Get this now. You want to get something custom made? How about custom rim building delivered in less than 4 weeks? That's unreal. That is the Charm Masterpiece program, and they've got unbeatable pricing policies as well. Whether it's mine diamonds or Canadian lab-grown diamonds, check them out. For more information, go to charmdiamondcenters.com. That's charmdiamondcenters.com.
All right, gang, listen up. It's time to learn the pro pose. Coach?
Bend and snap.
Beautiful form. Nice arm extension. Facial expression, I could use some work. All right, let's see it. The pro pose. What's that guy doing?
I think that's the bend and snap.
That's a whole different deal.
Charm, home of the pro pose.
Oh! The only thing sweeter than the taste of victory is starting your day with the new Cinnabon Pull Apart from Wendy's. But there's no reason you can't have both now that Wendy's and Daily Faceoff Fantasy are giving you a chance to win weekly prizes all season long. And hey, even if you make a few wrong picks, at least you know you're heading to Wendy's right now for a $5 Cinnabon pull apart and a small coffee. It's a great choice. Sign up for the Daily Faceoff Survivor Pool sponsored by Wendy's and the Wendy's app. Let's get back to the hockey talk. Afterburner returns.
All right, man. Let's look at the road ahead presented by Village Honda. Oh, man. We play the Sharks next. I saw they have 44 points.
Hey, they almost. Did they win today? Yeah, they did win tonight. 44 points, eh? I guess I guess they got dead last in lock.
What's the record for points? I don't even know. That's got to be close. It's got to be real close.
The real question here is, do we beat them?
Well, we've lost them. We lost them once this year. So it's probably a coin flip.
I honestly don't. I don't know.
The Flames have
like
one
to,
of the.
I would like to think yes, but I'm going to say yes. I'm going to say the Flames beat the Sharks.
The Flames have, like, I think the one of the worst, like 23rd or 24th worst percentage out of 32 teams of record against bad teams this year, of bottom five teams. And that's just not surprising at all. Can't do it. The road ahead is brought to you by Village Honda, Northwest Auto Mall, and online at villagehonda.com. There's new stock inventory on the ground. My dad told me to say this. He was like, you got to tell them. I just got a car from Village Honda, and it's great. So there you go.
What kind of car do you get?
My dad endorses Village Honda. It's a Toyota. It was used. But it's a great vehicle. 2024 Honda Accord was redesigned last year, Jordan. And it was chosen by Car and Driver magazine as the number one midsize sedan, one of the most reliable vehicles on the road. And it's better than ever. Village Honda has a huge selection of used vehicles. Apparently, according to my dad, they have great used vehicles. All makes, all models for all budgets, with over 70 units on site and access to over 400 more in their dealer group. Make Village Honda your one-stop automotive destination in Calgary. Northwest Auto Mall, get down there. So after the Sharks on Tuesday, Flames have a couple days off. Then they go, they got a nice little California road trip. Then they go LA on Thursday, back-to-back with the Ducks on Friday. The Ducks are another bad team that always seem to give us a hard time, eh?
Can't be the Hawks or the Ducks.
Or the Blue Jackets or the Sharks.
You had the Sharks twice. God, I just want this fucking season.
It's almost over, dude. It's almost over. You want to take some questions? We should get some questions. We should get to the chat, eh? We should get to
whatever
the
type of chat.
I hope it's wild in there after an Oilers game. Sorry, we went a little long.
I just realized we can see comments.
Oh, I haven't been paying attention at all, but I see that now.
There's a toggle. We're new at this little stream yard thing. Do you think we can get Evan Bouchard for Markstrom? Doubt it. Do you?
No.
Well, who knows if the Oilers falter hard in the offseason, because my whole thing is like, well, they seem pretty happy and content with their goaltending situation. Skinner seems – they all seem to think Skinner's a solid number one. Stu, well, how come every goaltender they have has a boo name for cheering? Huh? But I don't know. Do you even think that's a fair trade?
No, it's – no.
I don't think
Bouchard. How many points does he have in terms of defenseman? He's like right up there.
Bouch bomb.
I hate that cross-eyed goof.
All right, question: what, if any, UFAs or RFAs should the Flames target this offseason? Craig City's in on it.
Sean Monahan would be my answer.
I think first and foremost, you just want to address like what you're looking for. You're probably looking for a high-end goal scorer potentially.
So Sean Monahan.
Sean Monahan?
Yeah.
Who else on the list? I haven't even looked.
Well, I really hope they avoid. I don't want to see like, oh, we're signing Chandler Stephenson to a max term deal. Avoid those things at all costs. The Flames should be looking at really one thing and one thing only, short-term deals.
Very short-term,
Very short-term with guys you can – pump and dump, right? Like juice their stats, get a return at the deadline. That's the kind of guys you should be looking for. With the exception of Sean Monahan, don't pump and dump. Just bring Monty home. That's all I ask.
Bring him home. What was that meme that you – how did it go again? You lose Tkachuk, you lose Gaudreau, and you lose Monahan, and they're all your ex-girlfriends. And
yeah, so Gaudreau is like your first love, right? It's the girl you fell in love with in high school.
And breaks your heart.
Breaks your heart. Tkachuk is like the girl who you all was way out of your league, but like you went out with him anyways. And
she was always out of your league. It was never really gonna last.
Never gonna work. But Monty's like the one who like the you like overlooked and you never treated quite right. And they were always the one who was right for you. That's Sean Monahan.
Bring him home. Who should Conroy bring up from the Wranglers to end the season?
Well, I think everyone's pretty curious to get a look at Jeremy Poirier, but I did see fellow Nation writer and host of the show, Mike Gould, hyping up William Stromgren today. He's been playing very well as of late. You'll remember him famously for being the guy the Flames picked, I think, a pick or two before Logan Stankoven.
Oh, fuck, man.
So he's got that infamy, but he has been playing really well. So maybe Poirier or Stromgren, probably. I think Poirier, I would like to get a look at Poirier, but if Stromgren's playing well, and get him up here.
Except Huska seems to be doing this late season flex, eh?
Yeah, he'd probably, Poirier would probably come up and he'd probably pull a Daryl Sutter, what's his number, eh?
Oh, God.
Monge getting traded.
You know what? Until tonight, I've been like, I don't miss Monge Iupani one bit until tonight. Until tonight, I'm like, fuck, man. We just need somebody who could hopefully at least maybe score.
He could get traded. I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised if he's looking for a change too. Like, is he going to play? I don't know. He's been, to his credit, like, I know a lot of people are frustrated with him this year, but he has been Monge Iupani. He just hasn't been at that level that I think most of us were expecting him to get to when he, after he scored 30 goals.
What's he got? How many goals?
Fuck, dude. I don't know. Does he even have like 15? He must. But I would say if the right deal is there, both player and team would probably be interested in it. It's going to be a contract year for him. So
what type of scenario, if you're Craig Conroy, does trading Monge Iupani make sense to you?
Well, if he does, if it's, he's going to be a UFA.
Because you're going to
dealing with a UFA at the deadline.
And you're kind of assuming that maybe here he's leading towards a change of scenery. And maybe the team is too at this point. Too, let's
be honest. And if you can get something for him at the deadline, you have to explore that.
Is he a pump and dump potential?
Yeah, sure.
Should be selling. Sure. Fuck, man. How many times I
texted him? He has been rough.
I look, I'll give Shillington the benefit of the doubt. He came in, what, midseason? That's tough.
Yeah.
You know, for a player to really prepare themselves physically for the 82 grind that the NHL is, like, you need a solid offseason of training. You got to start early. Like, I don't know, but I agree. He's looked ass. He was all over the ice, falling over the place. He's a mess.
He's been in an elevated role. Like, he kind of came in to ease him in a bit, playing easy minutes. But like, obviously, maybe, since the blue line's been depleted and he hasn't been as sheltered,
maybe
he's had a
Huska,
hard time, man.
Maybe if you're Husky, you just sugarcoat it, give him a shit sandwich, and just like, you know what? Yeah. I think let's just great comeback. He got nominated for the Mastersons, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like, that's,
I mean,
that's huge.
I mean, yeah, overcoming something like that is like, a mental health issue is probably not something you just overcome and it's done with, right? Like,
yeah.
That's a really tough thing to deal with.
I know the organization probably trying to do things delicately with him, but I still think you can explain it to him in a way. It's just like, you know what? We want to take a look at some new guys. We're out of it. Amazing comeback season, but I agree. Not helping the team right now.
We need Tanev back.
Ooh, if you really look at the timeline of what you said, lost eight of the last 10. And was it 10 games ago was the deadline? Like, it's maybe
little,
before that.
A little longer than
we had a little bit of like a nice, what, 3-game win streak after the trade deadline or something like that.
Well, they got shit canned by like Carolina, Colorado, and Florida all 3 in a row, but then they went on a nice little streak.
I said this to you after Dallas shit canned the Oilers the other night. Like, I'm going to be cheering for Tanev, I think, for the season.
Dallas and Winnipeg are my bandwagon teams. You're going Monty or Tanev. If Tanev wanted to come back on a short, I don't know. I don't even know if it makes sense. But I love Chris Tanev. So if you want to bring him back.
Well, he's going to be sought after. He's going to be sought after.
Oh, dude, totally. Vancouver's going to make a hard
push. He might be one of those guys that gets a big payday for a 1-2 year contract. Jay Frey.
What's up, Josh? How you doing, man?
If/when we trade Markstrom, what team are you guys thinking he goes to?
Fuck, dude. I don't know. Who's in the market for a goalie?
Somebody threw out Colorado potentially today on Twitter. That kind of made sense to me.
Well,
like, I don't know.
Yeah,
I think maybe the best way to slice it down is who gets punked early in the playoffs and realizes, fuck, we need a goalie. Maybe that's...
Yeah, that's kind of maybe the flip side of worrying about not trading Markstrom at the deadline, which I, in for me personally, I do feel like was a mistake, probably. The flip side of that is there probably will be more teams in the offseason who possibly will be interested. And I mean, Markstrom controls all this, so it does get complicated. But like you're saying, if Colorado gets curb stomped and their goaltending was terrible and they look at Markstrom and say, yeah, he's a guy who's only under contract for two more years, let's go get him. I don't know. LA apparently tried to get him. I don't know if that was substantiated or not. And he
at the deadline?
Yeah, and he apparently blocked it or something. I don't think that ever really was substantiated by anybody, but that was out there. A team that actually does make sense for me because their goaltending is atrocious and they're really trying to take the next step into being competitive is Ottawa. You watch Brady Tkachuk after tonight's game. He's like fucking pissed that they still stink.
Dude, I watched the highlights. What a beast.
He's a beast. And their goaltending stinks. So that's a team. They've shown a – they're under new management, so I don't think you're going to be like – well, I don't know. Maybe the new management isn't any better than the old management. But that's a team that kind of makes sense for me. So maybe Ottawa.
Yeah, I think you're right. The offseason should open up some more potential. Especially, especially I think Markstrom – maybe in season, he's not necessarily, you know, going to go along with, you know, different trade proposals. But if you can sit him down in the off season and, you know, maybe he really starts thinking about stuff, then maybe he's more open to, you know, to saying yes to more
destinations. New Jersey still makes sense, even though they have Jake Allen. Marty Brodeur apparently loves the guy, so.
I think Zary should stay at center from now on. What do you guys think?
Yeah, I do too.
Well, it's a pretty small sample size. I want to see him finish out the season at center, maybe start the season at center.
Well, you just want to get a look at it. It's an organizational need. It's an organizational weakness is lack of center prospects and young centers.
So for now, no, I would say, yeah, keep molding him in that direction. But I don't know if you can necessarily say from now on timestamp it, right? But
I just think of like when they tried, like, how did they utilize Bennett? Like, he comes in as an 18-year-old in the playoffs. I don't know if he's playing center in the playoffs.
Did they utilize Bennett?
But like, Bennett was on the wing, like, he was all over the place. And I'm not like, they just totally fucked it up. And then he goes to Florida and is a center and has been a really solid player ever since.
So, day one, center, power play, penalty kill, all situations.
You just, why not know now, right?
Yep.
So, yes.
Yeah, good point, Noah. What's the highest spot you would take Tiege at?
This two overall at this rate, dude.
Right? Actually?
No.
No. But the latest, was it?
Elite prospects. They're like
updated
prospect rankings.
They have
them at six.
Sixth.
They have them at six.
We had the exact same conversation, a week and a half ago. And you basically said, well, if you're picking outside the top 10, take him if he's still there. But if you're in the, you know, if you're eight or lower where we're at now, maybe you go for trying to get a solid number one defenseman. But dude, and I think potentially what it has been is they played four playoff games.
Yeah, they played last night. He scored again last night. They lost.
So he has six goals in four playoff games. I saw him play a regular season game he scored. I went to game three, their first home game, saw him in person. This guy is fucking legit. He is good. He's got sneaky good speed. He's 17 and he scored 48 goals.
47 this year.
As a 17-year-old in the WHL, just can score goals at will. And his speed is unreal. It's like Drome was never known for his speed.
Or his skill, necessarily.
Like he's got sneaky, sneaky speed, sneaky strong, plus he's going to develop into a man. We already know how big of a beast Drome was. Like, genetics. We know the genetics, folks. And he can snipe like his dad easily.
I think the best way I've put it so far is, given where we're likely to pick, I don't think at this point there's a forward available that I would pick over him where we would pick. It would probably just be if any of those defensemen were still on the board that you'd probably have a hard time passing one of those guys up. But I think if you're picking at eight, it's very reasonable at this point.
At this point.
Yeah.
Because he just keeps climbing up those prospect Daryl Sutter said that Tej is not a top, did he say 8 or 10? Not a top 10. The thing is like, I know we had this conversation before, is when you always go back and redo the drafts. Like, if you redo Jerome McGinley's draft, he goes number 1 overall. And it's just like, I don't know. It's so hard to know. But the more this goes on, the more likely you're willing to take him.
Well, here's the – okay, I'll say one more thing on the tease thing is, like, at some point – like, here's what would be totally fucked up. It's like, sometimes we just have to remember that this is – being a fan is about having fun. And this would be really fun.
Gee, yeah. Is it?
And – it would be an absolute travesty if the Flames passed on Tej Ginla because, like, some, like, bullshit about, like, oh, we just don't want to look like we're picking him because of his name. It would be a travesty if Tej turns into a solid NHL player or even a star and we pass on him. Like, that would be...
even bigger.
We'd look back on that and just be like, that's such a mistake.
Did you post that? Somebody posted it. Like, what would be worse?
Yeah. What's worse?
Passing on Tej and he becomes a stud? Or... going for Tej and he doesn't become a stud.
Yeah, the former is worse. Daryl Sutter said that we should trade up with our pick from Vancouver. Yeah, I think I don't know if you could trade up that far though.
Yeah, it's like, and the other point is, you're right. Right now, it almost seems like, yeah, is it nepotism or is it reverse nepotism?
It seems like amongst the Twitter fan community, it's becoming reverse nepotism.
So now you don't want to pick him because of his name.
Yeah, yeah.
Fuck that. Pick him because of
dude, we have one chance. This is a one in a billion chance.
Imagine.
We can get both Ginla brothers. Can you fucking imagine? Can you imagine? 2027 comes around and it's Tej and Joe.
Get the fuck out of here. And Jerome. When is Connie going to give up the C or the...
yeah, Connie's going to let give the GM chair to Jerome, eh?
Right?
Yeah.
This is just going to be Jerome family running the show.
We have one chance. We have one chance to do this. You look at how cool it is. The Hughes brothers are in New Jersey, and they have no tie to that team. Imagine the Iggy Bros. Imagine dude, the new arena. We got the Iggy Bros. We signed Cale Makar in the summer of 2027. The vibes would be so immaculate.
Imagine they're both studs.
So take Tej. Come on.
And what happens if the Flames make a big jump in the lottery?
Oh, it's a different story.
What are the chances of that, though? Especially since it's probably rigged.
Yeah. Chicago's going to get it. You wouldn't take them top 3, so.
So, basically how it works is if you're picking top 10, then you have a chance to move to number 1?
You can move up 10 spots, so anybody in the top 11. I think that's right.
Yeah, but it rarely happens, especially the teams like in the top 3 to 5. Maybe there's some movement, but hey, I'm not saying it's not possible. But yes, then yes, everything changes depending on where you go.
Yeah.
Where was this PP all season?
Good fucking question.
Well, Kuzmenko is maybe a big part of it.
Huge part of it. The fact they've got Uyghur, you know, the guy who leads the league. In even strength goals and is third in the league amongst defenseman goals now on their fucking finally. That's probably a big factor.
So they didn't have the young bud Deans. They didn't have the same personnel all season we're seeing right now.
Well, and they didn't make the adjustments and probably just getting a little bit of shooting luck here.
Well, I think they're looking out. Yeah, I agree.
It has been looking a little bit better as of late.
I still want to see more cross.
Yeah. I still want to see what you saw from the Oilers tonight, right?
Oh, dude. You have Draisaitl just sitting there waiting. So McDavid, he's always a threat to slide over to Draisaitl, just sitting there with the stick cocked, ready to go. Same with the Ovechkin, you know what's going to happen. But Bouchard is like, what, 6 to 10 feet always? So if you're going to cut off one passing lane, you can't cut off both. So they're both ready. Both ready, sitting, waiting. All McDavid has to do is a little up and down, create a little space. He's going to find a seam. That's how the power play is so good. And you just have, what was it early, the first power play? I'm like, whoa. Everybody was a one-time option. They were just moving around, and just so deadly. Those one-timers, cross-sizes are so hard to save. Anyways, all right, PP's been better. Yeah. PP's been better. We'll see how it goes.
We got one more question.
Who would you place for Savard with as the power play coach? Jenny wants to know. I don't know.
It's kind of a bummer because I was so stoked when they named him the power play coach. You know, beloved. Well, he's more of a cult hero in Calgary because if you were here when he was a Flame, he was really good until they totally fucked up and traded him for nothing.
Anybody committed to studying the top five power plays in the NHL and doing what they
I'll tell you who I don't want him replacing him is Glenn Gulletson. If I have to, anytime I see that goofball's face on the broadcast, A, I get annoyed. B, I cannot believe he keeps surviving all these Oilers coach firings. How many has he survived at this point? He's just like the cockroach of the Oilers. How does he still have a job? Like, just because the power play is out of this world because McDavid's out of his mind?
Yes. How many people in the league does McDavid just employ?
Yeah.
Just on his sheer skill alone.
Well, he employs Connor Brown, who scored it. We let score on us tonight. He employs the coach of the team. The whole staff.
What's Zach Hyman's contract look like? Like, when's his next payday?
Well, I think he signed the same year Coleman did, so it's not for a little while here.
Right. They're similar contracts, weren't they?
Anyways,
one scoring 20.
What do you do with – I don't know if you fire Savard in the offseason. I don't know if that's on the cards. The one guy that was kind of interesting they were talking to is Alex Tanguay, who's – I think he's in Detroit now. So, Connie, roll up your Rolodex, see old Flames who are good on the power play, and pick somebody.
I'd be down with Tanguay for sure. All right, that's a wrap. Right,
do we have any more questions? We're good?
Nope, no more, boys.
No more questions.
All right, you want to take us home? All right,
guys. Well, thanks for hanging out. I really would – man, fuck, dude. I really would have liked to win tonight. But, hey, you got a decent effort. It's all in service of the tank. To the tank gods, we thank you. We give our thanks. So, good night. Would have liked to beat the Oilers.
There was no greasy satisfaction tonight.
But we'll get them next year, boys.
We'll get them next decade.
Peace, everybody.